Before I get into what I'm going to do, this is probably the only part of the presentation where you all get to talk back to me. And so, since I can't really see any of you, I'm just going to have you just yell out the answer. What's in the news right now? What's everyone talking about? Give me a couple of topics.
Roy Moore.
Yeah, Roy Moore. Anything else? What's in the news?
Sexual harassment.
Gun control. What was that?
Louis C.K.
Yeah, Louis too.
Italian soccer team.
Italy lost, man. What, first time, what, 60 years? Yeah, that's bad. That's bad. I'm going to talk to you now about what I do, my commitment as a journalist, why I tell stories, why I report. And then we're going to flip the script a little bit and talk about your commitment in terms of being a news consumer. So why do we tell stories? We know about the ant and the grasshopper, right? We all read that when we were little, what the ant did, what the grasshopper did, and we all know how that turned out. So, storytelling. We all know about who, what, when, where, why. Because they sort of teach you that, you know, journalism 101, the first day in J school. You know, as a journalist, you gotta report the who, what, when, where, and why. You gotta tell people what they don't know. You gotta inform the listener. You gotta inform the reader. All right, we're gonna get to that in a second. Telling stories. It's old. It's nothing new. For you young people, that is a printing press on the left side. You're probably more familiar with YouTube, because for a lot of people, that's how they get their information. YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, social media. And I always ask people to understand this. There's a difference when you say social media and news media. So when you say, well, I saw it on the internet, so it must be true, think about where are you consuming this information from. I'm going to get to that in just a minute. So, commitment to you, the news consumer. This is my commitment to you. First of all, it's the truth, right? When you listen to the news, when you read the news, when you hear the news, you're hoping that it's the truth. That is part of my commitment to you, the consumer, the news consumer. I have to tell you the truth. It's my job to tell you the truth, right? No slants, no biases. I love cats. I love all animals. But I once got an email that said, you must don't like dogs because you talk about your cats a lot. No, that's not true. I love all animals. If I'm reporting on something, no slant, no biases. I know it sounds very simplistic, Rose is talking about cats and dogs. But think about it this way. I'm a woman of color. I'm a reporter. So if I'm reporting on something that deals with people of color, am I going to have a bias? I shouldn't. If I'm reporting on something that deals with cats and dogs, should I have a bias? I shouldn't, no matter the topic. No slant, no bias. That's part of my commitment to you, the news consumer. Many angles, many perspectives. What does that mean? My commitment to you, the news consumer, is I give you many perspectives, many angles, no matter what the issue is. Somebody mentioned gun control. Can't be one-sided, right? Has to be various viewpoints. That's my commitment to you, the news consumer. Presenting data and credible sourcing. If I give you a figure, if I say 1 in 5 people don't like eggs, what's my source? Well, I talked to Farmer Joe down the street. No, that's not a credible source. My commitment to you, the news consumer, is to have data that is applicable, that's accurate, and I have credible sourcing. That's my commitment to you, as a journalist, to the news consumer. Honest in reporting and transparent. What does that mean? Well, depending on who you're asking, there are a lot of different things. I have to be honest in my reporting. I have to be transparent. And you say, what does that mean to be transparent? Well, I'll give you an example. I did a story on the Atlanta cheating club. I did many stories on the Atlanta cheating scandal with the APS. APS holds a license to my radio station. WAVE is a public radio station. So every time I did a story about the Atlanta Public Schools and a cheating scandal, I had to disclose that WAVE's broadcast license is held by the Atlanta Public Schools. That lets you, the news consumer, know I'm transparent, I'm not hiding anything. My commitment to you, based on the other factors there, is that I am presenting the information, but you also need to know that the Atlanta Public Schools holds our broadcast license. That way you can't say, oh, they're not covering this because APS holds that broadcast license. They do that. Voices seldom heard. I got into this business because when I would listen to the news and when I would watch the news, I didn't hear a lot of stories about people from my community. I didn't hear a lot of stories about the Hispanic community. I didn't hear a lot of stories about the rural community. I got into this to be able to tell stories of people you seldom hear from. And that's something I'm still doing to this day. I'm very proud of it too. What did I accomplish by doing all of those things? If you're the consumer, if you're the listener, if you're the reader, I hope I accomplished all of those things. I can't tell you what to think, how to think, but maybe give you something to think about. I can't tell you who to vote for. I can't tell you not to vote for. I can just give you something to think about. That way you become an informed consumer. This is why we tell stories. Is it relevant? Is it timely? Well, right now everyone's talking about sexual assault. Maybe the Italian soccer team, I don't know, maybe just in Italy. You know? Is it relevant? Is it timely? Are we presenting unfamiliar voices? Remember a slide ago I just talked about presenting voices seldom heard? Am I giving you new information? And is it authentic? This is all part of my commitment to you, the news consumer, as the journalist. This is part of my commitment. And we're going to get to your commitment in just a second. How do you consume your news? Now we get to be interactive again. Who gets their news by listening to NPR? Yay! Who gets their news by doing the old-fashioned way, reading the AJC at the table? Anybody? AJC, paper? Newspaper? All right. New York Times? Good one. Who gets their news by going to Twitter? It's okay, you can admit it. Or Facebook? Or Bob from the gym, who's on your Facebook? There is a Bob from the gym. But how do you consume your news? Think about that. Now, the commitment to the consumer of the news. When I put this together, I started thinking, you know, we always talk about what the role is of the news media, the role of the journalist, but we never really talk about the role of the consumer. You have a responsibility too. No, I'm not going to preach to you, but I want you to think about something. So remember when I talk about who, what, when, where, why? Well, that applies to you all as well. So think about this the next time you're reading or listening. Who's reporting information? Is it a liberal media outlet? Is it conservative? Is it a social journalist? Is it Bob from the gym? Think about who's reporting information. What are they reporting? Are they reporting that candidate X, who's a Republican, is being unfairly treated? Candidate B, who's a Democrat, is being unfairly treated? Think about that. Think about what they're reporting. And all this is going to tie in just a second. When are they reporting this? What's the climate of the nation? So we're talking about sexual assault. That's big news now. So every news story about every allegation, everything that you hear is timely, right? Because it's relevant, maybe. So think about when they reported this. What's the climate of the nation? What's the news cycle? Where are they reporting? The location of the story. We had Hurricane Irma. Everybody was down there. That was important. Puerto Rico, that was important. Think about that. If you're getting your news from Bob from the gym, and Bob was just relaying something that somebody else said, well, Think about where Bob is reporting that from. Bob's a social journalist, so we'll let Bob report. But think about your news outlet. Think about where you're getting your information from. Think about where they're reporting from. Because how can you tell a story if you're not there? Now, sometimes we all sit behind the desk and we sit behind the mic. But as a commitment to the consumer of news, wouldn't you want me to be there if possible? Wouldn't you want me to be there to interview people firsthand? Think about that. Why are they reporting information? It kind of goes back to, when are they reporting it? Why are we hearing about sexual assault claims and allegations? It's in the news. Why are we hearing about Roy Moore? Because another person has come forward. Why are we hearing about gun control? Because we have another mass shooting. All this is important to you. You may not think about it. You may say, well, Rose, look, I just want to turn on the TV or turn on the radio because I just want to know what's happening in the world. That's fine. But think about where you're turning it down to, where you're turning your channel to, whatever it is. I don't care what it is. Just think about it. If I have a commitment to you as a journalist, you have a commitment to yourself to make sure you're getting accurate information and not fake news. I know the scripture is probably disturbing for some people, and if you want to close your eyes, that's fine. I'll tell you when it's over. And I'll tell you why all those other things are so important that we just talked about. That is a 14-year-old boy by the name of Emmett Till. Jet Magazine in 1955 published this photo. And many believe this helped kind of start the civil rights movement. A lot of people didn't know what was happening in southern states. Yeah, you heard about segregation. You might have heard about Jim Crow. You might have heard about the Klan lynching African Americans and Jewish folks. When Jet Magazine published this photo of a 14-year-old boy who had been beaten by a group of white men for allegedly whistling at a white woman, a lot changed. A lot changed in how journalists were reporting what was happening, and a lot changed in terms of how people consume news. I'm going to fast forward the slides so you can open your eyes. She looks familiar. That is me in 2013 in Amman, Jordan, interviewing a woman who had just fled Syria with her kids. She had six kids. Her husband, their dad, was not with them. They didn't know that their father was never coming back. They didn't know that he had lost an arm in a bomb blast and had to tragically bleed to death because there was no hospital to take him to. So she fled Syria with her six kids. The opportunity for me to go to Syria to tell a story, to localize as best as we could what was happening for our listeners. And I followed the organization CARE. I followed them through every journey in trying to help refugees from Syria. It's a part of my commitment to being a journalist. I can sit and tell you, oh, there's this happening in Syria, but until I had the opportunity to go there for my station and send reports back. By the way, it was an 8-hour time difference. I got no sleep, but it's okay. Me not having sleep fails in comparison to what this woman went through. My commitment to the listener is to tell stories. It's a little fuzzy. This is the Peachtree Pine Homeless Shelter, the one that just closed in Midtown Atlanta. And all the years being in Atlanta and hearing about Peachtree Pine Shelter not one news organization has spent more than an hour inside that place to really, really tell you the stories that were going on. You just heard it was a bad place. There was a TB outbreak. So my producer and I, Candace, we spent 6 hours there talking to the people, talking to a young mother who was once thrown out on drugs and came to the shelter to get help. Talked to a young man who had been released from prison, but through the work of the shelter, got his GED and was taking care of the rooftop garden. You have never heard that story. My commitment to the consumer of news is to tell stories you don't hear. And all those other things I mentioned about being authentic and telling the truth, all that goes together. But you still have to tell a story that nobody is hearing. Take a listen to this.
One of my favorite video games to play is either Dragon Age or Skyrim, because I like the whole fantasy element, and in both of those games you get to choose your gender, you know, male, female, and your armor and stuff, and you get to customize their face, how they look, and I like that element in a video game, which is for obvious reasons.
That's important to you though, right?
It is important to me.
Why?
Just because I never wanted to be a boy, ever. I never wanted to be, and I never want to be. You know, I don't want to be in video games or real life. Some people would say it's just a video game, but to me, it's a way to escape my reality.
That is Brit from a couple of years ago. And all the conversations and all the news reporting we heard about parents of transgender teens. Never heard from a teen. So we found a family. I asked Britt to come in and speak to me. For the first time in my life, the night before, I did not know how to start this conversation. I've been doing this since I was 19 years old, and I'm 40 something. I said, you know what? I'm just going to go in and wing it. So Britt came in, she sat down, and I looked at her t-shirt. And on that t-shirt, I said, who's that? She said, oh, it's Harley Quinn from the Batman series or whatever. And that's how our conversation started. And I let her talk. This is an example of voices seldom heard. And the feedback was outstanding. Some people didn't like it. Some people said, oh, why'd you interview her? Well, why not? How do we measure effective outcomes of a news story? Well, now herein lies the rub. Whether you're at this intersection of the internet, television, radio, newspapers, magazines, media, I don't know how we measure the effectiveness of a story. Is it, am I impacting change? That's really not my job. My job is just to tell a story, present the information. Anything that comes out of that, whether it's change in legislation, change in policies, kids protesting the broccoli in the lunchroom, that's not my mission. My mission is to inform. If my mission is to get clicks, feedback and retweets and all these shares and likes and all that, then all those things I talked about before in the other slides don't really matter if that's just my mission. I know today, this day and age, it's all about clicks and headlines. But for me and for many of my colleagues, especially at WNBE, we go beyond that. If you click on a story, that's great. If you share it, that's great. But our commitment, our dedication to you, the news consumer, is all the things I just talked about. What do you see? You can yell it out, we're interactive. What do you see in this slide? Go ahead. I'm not going to get mad. Go ahead. What do you see? Anybody?
A poster.
Poster.
People.
Protest.
Power.
Frustration. I didn't want to leave out my photojournalist colleagues because they're just as important as well. And yes, it's true that a picture tells a thousand words. What do you see?
A fight.
A fight? What else?
Violence.
Anybody? I'm sorry?
Violence.
Anger.
Also compassion.
Compassion?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Why do I tell stories? Why do we look for it? Well, I'll tell you why I report and why I tell stories. If I don't, if I'm not authentic, if I'm not transparent, if it's not relevant, if it's not timely, if I'm not telling stories, if I'm not telling the truth, if there's no slant, if I mix all that up, I think I'm doing a pretty good job. That's my commitment to you. But think about your commitment as the viewer, as the listener, as the reader. And then think about what you do with that information. Again, I can't tell you what to do with it, but you can think about what you want to do with it. And by the way, if you ever listen, and I'm not doing all those things I talked to you about, go ahead and send me an email, it's easy, rose@wabe.org. Thank you.